2021 will officially be the year for Hytale, as confirmed by the developers in one of four brand new blog posts that released this Wednesday. Caught us a little off guard there, Noxie, but after a few months of community unease, they've hit back strong with not only a timeline, but also some much needed updates and some explanations for their lack of communication this year. Now the only question is, when's the beta coming? What, too soon? Welcome back to Kweebec Corner, and today we're diving into everything the Hypixel team revealed this week, including our first ever glimpse at unedited gameplay and how it links back to previous content we've seen so far. Not only that, we're going to look at how this extended timeline will impact the artists, creators, and Hytale community alike as we gear up for the long haul. Let's cue the brand new soundtrack pieces because it's time to jump into some blog posts. This video is sponsored by Server Pro. Server Pro has everything you need to host the next big Hytale server. With custom host names and support for modding and scripting, why not start your adventure today and grab a Minecraft server that you can swap over at launch? As we expected, the start of the year had the team widen their scope in response to the huge amount of attention the trailer received, causing them to rethink their plans and withdraw from public a little as they prepared for new opportunities and bigger challenges. While immensely grateful, the team are, quote, still modders at heart, and such a spotlight has been rather intimidating for them. But they understand the expectations of the game and plan to produce the best product possible now that they've had a chance to take a step back and restock. The team also wanted to reassure us that while plans have been escalating over the course of the year, as players themselves, they understand the worries that come with this, and we shouldn't feel concerned about the spirit of the game being lost as stakes and budgets increase. It was confirmed that the mid-2019 silence was due to ongoing development and partnership delays, with some expected setbacks often causing posts to be revised completely. They have, however, heard our cry, and while for the most part they wanted to keep teases to launch-ready features, they have decided that showing more work-in-progress aspects and actively seeking feedback will ensure they head in the right direction. Finally, the team thank us for our ongoing support and dedication to the game, and they want to be sure that they avoid miscommunication again, highlighting that this information is a plan that can change and may well do so if it threatens the sanctity of the developers and the game itself. On a more brighter note, the team have been incorporating two new biomes over the last few weeks, such as the Autumn Forest that was probably inspired during the Halloween period, judging by those pumpkins. A densely wooded area where the leaves have turned deep orange and brown, explore to find mushrooms, pumpkins, crops, and some decorative glowing fauna. A new biome for Zone 2 was also revealed, called the Oasis. These verdant areas provide stark contrast to the desert wilderness, and an opportunity to harvest materials that may not be easy to find elsewhere. Be mindful, however, you're not the only creature that may be drawn to an isolated lagoon. My personal theory is that these creatures that they're referring to are the crocodiles we've spotted lurking around the website. Speaking of crocodiles, let's take a look at some of the creatures and mobs that were revealed during these blog posts. Did you know that there were actually 15 mobs hidden around these images? Let's go through them real quick. This image not only had the obvious deerlings feeding, but also a bear in the background camouflaged by a tree, and a flock of birds flying by, as well as an owl roosting in its own cute little nest. We got an exclusive look at a Feren without its dangerous skull-looking helmet. Take a look at this character here. I bet you didn't spot that right in the background of the farm, there's actually a Kweebec planted into the farm, like a vegetable. We also got a little glimpse of a Yeti poking around in the woods. We of course saw a bison and a Kweebec elder in the banner. An outlander, as well as an undead that looks strangely familiar. And while people were probably mesmerized about this weird character's armor and the swampy area, I bet you didn't spot this rat right at the end of the tunnel. And last but not least, we got a glimpse at two dinosaurs, probably the mobs that people were most excited to see this week. There's something I just can't get over about this teaser. It harkens back to a zone in World of Warcraft called Ungoro Crater that also features overgrown reptiles. What I'd like to focus on is the illuminescent nature of both these creatures. We know we'll fend off against these guys deep within the jungle caves of Zone 3, and having been driven underground, we can assume that they've somehow evolved neon lights as part of their anatomy to find their way through these dark caverns. It'll be intriguing to see what other species are out there and confirmed for the game. Not only were we surprised by the blog post, but we also got blindsided by our first unedited gameplay footage, including multiplayer combat, spellcasting, and audio. Naturally, the team said they expect the clip to be closely analyzed, so let's do just that. At first, we catch a glimpse at some armor types that are most likely wooden. I think we've seen Kweebecs donning similar pieces. Note that we see an axe, mace, one-handed sword and shield, bow and arrow, dagger, spellcasting book, and staff during this footage, as well as a two-handed sword right at the very end. The silver steel blade also suggesting the existence of metal alloys, as touched on in a Twitter thread by Shadrock. We've now also got an updated view of the UI. We have a health, hunger, and armor bar, as well as a directional compass at the top, and of course a hotbar for your items. Beyond this is a quest objective tracker, as well as 5 hotkey icons. This pop-up here appears when you pick up items, and item names appear above your hotbar when selected, similar to Minecraft. Fun fact, the enemy counter actually stops and doesn't count the last skelly guy there and stays at 5 instead of going to 6. Looking at the combat, we can jump right into things by seeing our duo gear up with a sword and shield, both being equipped at the same time as well. Now we don't see the other player's hotbar, but the fact that you can quickly equip a one-handed sword and shield at the same time shows the team's desire for versatility in combat. Attack swings seem to move from left to right almost like a combo, and the mace in particular causing a knockback effect that seems to also bash the skeleton into the other charging enemy. This is a really neat touch, by the way. As player 2 flanks the other mobs, our main POV avoids an arrow and charges up some sort of special attack combined with a jump. It's unsure to say if this was a charge and a critical jump, or if it was just a special attack timed well with a jump. The POV uses the silver steel blade to then finish off the skeletal spellcaster and pick up the book for themselves. The team have stressed that they don't want to alienate players with talent trees, so let's just assume that you can pick up and use these books no matter who you are. The next magic source comes from the enemy's staff as it casts green bolts. It seems you have to be pretty accurate at the cost of bearing magic, and it looks like a mechanic that could be utilized really well in different game modes. Finally, the player draws the power from the book to help player 2 jump in and finish off the remaining enemies with some nicely timed blocks. Now, there's a lot to take in here, so what you may not have noticed is the damage indicator on your crosshair, this appearing when you take damage from physical hits and a smaller point indicating when you take damage from arrows. And while the enemy AI seems somewhat basic, we also have to remember that this dungeon takes place in the ruins of the Emerald Grove, in Zone 1, so we will still be getting introduced to the mechanics at this point. At the end, the players find a chest with a green crystal, similar to one that we've seen before. I'm going to go ahead and assume these are emeralds. The Emerald Grove emeralds kinda makes sense, I guess. Perhaps the whole element emerald color stuff is also the reason why magic being used here is green, but more on that in a future video. The team also touched on graphics, very importantly. The custom engine built over 4 years that runs the game has had major overhauls, with real-time shadows, bloom, and improved water effects like reflections being added by engine developers. More info on specs were released when they mentioned, Hytale will be fully playable on a low-end system with an integrated graphics card. Many features will work on integrated Intel GPUs. You will have the option to customize your graphics settings to suit your setup. Although they noted that some more performance-heavy additions like sunshafts are currently not compatible with integrated graphics cards, they are an example of what can be achieved with more powerful hardware. So, it seems that people who are concerned about performance shouldn't need to worry too much. And besides, you've got a year to save up for a better PC now anyway. While we know the game is looking great now, we can only begin to imagine what will be going on when the beta finally drops. For now, let's leave the news to settle in with the community. Already people are taking to YouTube with their analysis and breakdowns, and it'll be interesting to see how everyone fares with the new timeline laid out for them. Let's not forget that while the launch comes in 2021, beta obviously has to come earlier. The average beta runs for about 12 to 18 weeks, plus time required for bug fixing and applying all the feedback from that time, and you're looking at the team needing at least a 5 to 6 month window to push out beta testing before launch. As I mentioned in an earlier video, it's possible that the best time for Hytale to release is spring of 2021, therefore landing a beta somewhere around the last 2 quarters of 2020. Again, just a theory, I'm not promising anything here. However, if I am promising anything, for the last month I've been trying to organize and put things into place so that we have a schedule here on the channel for the first half of next year, with a Hytale news update, Hytale theory talk, Hytale fan art wars, and a soon-to-be-announced series releasing each month. I'll hold off on announcing the special series until sometime in December, but rest assured, Hytale coverage will remain in the corner. I wanted to thank anyone that participated in my Hytale fan art competition that went on Twitter during the last month. I'll be announcing the winner shortly. Thank you very much for watching Kweebec Corner, stay safe, and keep free.